Okay, good evening. It's welcome. But jao chaleke. So with the good evening, everybody. With the permission of Professor Chaudhary, we'll start the clinical meeting today, convened by Bengal Urologic Society. We have got Dr. Kumar, from uro-oncologist from Narayani Hospital, and he will be first of all talking about BCG toxicity, and then there will be a two-case discussion. So shall we start with the BCG toxicity? Abhay.
Sir, I'm humbled because I think I'm the most junior most person in this meeting here, and maybe I may not be prepared to to discuss certain things, which is, I mean, I've learned from you people basically. I thought disease will be there, so I had two cases to discuss with him, but we'll discuss among ourselves. Yeah. First presentation is about BCG toxicity. Okay. So for non-muscle invasive bladder cancers,
BCG is very important in management, but we are faced with a lot of complications and patients' problems, and for that we have to sometimes discontinue the treatment and manage the complications, of course. So I'll be dealing with what are the things to can be done to decrease the toxicity, and how can we prevent the toxicity, among other things. So it's a problem, and who deal with BCGs, they acknowledge that it's actually a problem. Sometimes patients come with the BCG toxicity in the OPD, and you can make out from the face, and sometimes we call it BCG facies. So when looking at the face, you can tell this problem, this is having some BCG problem with the patient. So at present, BCG is the only agent that reduces the progression rate to muscle invasion, reduces the need for cystectomy, and increases the time to cystectomy. And for this, we have to thank these people, Albert Calmette and Camille Curran, from Pasteur Institute, who discovered this BCG. And subsequently, Dr. Morales, in 1976, he first described how 6 weekly intravesical and percutaneous doses of, so basically it was combined percutaneous and intravesical doses of 120 milligram of Frappier strain of BCG, which was shown to decrease the bladder cancer recurrence by 12-fold. And whatever regimen we follow now, or maybe they're there in the guidelines, are further because of the studies done by this fellow, Dr. Donald Lamb, and that's why the protocol is also named by him after his name, called Lamb protocol. So he was the first to demonstrate in clinical trial setting the efficacy of intravesical immunotherapy, and the SWOZ studies under his direction demonstrated the superiority of BCG compared to other chemotherapy cutaneous agents which were used that time to decrease the recurrence, like mitomycin, gemcitabine, doxorubicin. And the further studies demonstrated the 3-week maintenance doses of immunotherapy were beneficial in decreasing the risk of recurrence and progression. So why we are talking about this toxicity, why we bother about this toxicity, and what kind of patients should receive the BCG, and what are the strategies of to minimize the toxicity, and what are the treatment available for established cases of BCG toxicity, and what may be the spectrum toxicity, I will discuss in the subsequent slides. So symptoms of toxicity can be described or maybe categorized into two parts, that is one local and systemic. Local problems can be cystitis, hematuria, contracted bladder, or granulomatous prostatitis, or epidermoarchitis. While systemic signs can be sepsis, fulminant hepatitis, pneumonitis, osteomyelitis, arthritis, fever of unknown origin, or mycotic aneurysm, psoriasis, and various others. So this was pointers. So this was the study by Lamb. He had around 2,600 patients, and you can see the complications type and the incidences. So they were quite high. I mean, it's problematic drug basically, not very easy to administer. And the pathogenesis is described in two ways. One is thought that it's a kind of hypersensitivity reaction and can occur with any dose or maybe at any time during the course of treatment. And the other theory is it's because of the hyperorganisms. The other theory is regarding the organism, because they have seen the live organisms in the cases which were treated and subsequently developed toxicities in like lung, liver, brain and pancreas. So then what is the criteria for giving this drug, and how long the patient should take these drugs? This is the standard risk stratification that we use, EORTC risk. It's taken from European Urology guidelines. We are talking about guidelines only, not other literature, because this is the one which we follow in usual clinical practice. So NMIBC or non-muscle invasive bladder cancers, according to Bruce, can be categorized into low risk, intermediate risk or high risk for recurrence and progression. Low risk are small, less than 3 cm, solitary lesions, papillary, TA and low grade. And high risk are T1, high grade, CIS, and if all of them are, these are like multiple TA, G1 tumors or recurrent tumors. So whichever doesn't fit into the first and the last fits into the intermediate category. So it's very easy basically. T1 high grade competency is recurrent more than 3 cm and multiple tumors are high risk. So what the guidelines says, not all the patients of NMIBC should be treated with BCG because of risk of toxicity. And the choice depends on the patient's risk of progression and recurrence according to this EORTC criteria. Because the BCG does not alter the natural course of low-risk tumors, so it should not be used for the low-risk tumors. In high-risk tumors, now we do sometimes for non-muscle invasive bladder cancers, cystectomy. So the patients who are not candidate for cystectomy, but they are high risk for recurrence and progression, we can be used BCG. So then the duration may be 1 year, 3 years, depends on the further risk stratification. And the additional benefit, whether the patient should get the drug for the second year or third year, should be weighed against the toxicity and the cost involved and the inconvenience concerned with the patient. In the intermediate risk patients, whether the full dose or reduced dose, 1 year or further, there are a lot of controversies. But for our practical purposes and all for guidelines purposes, we use full dose BCG for 1 year. Chemotherapy can be also be used in these patients, so it's a gray zone. But the final choice should reflect the individual patient's risk of recurrence and progression, whether it's a high risk or low risk, and the side effect of the how the patient is tolerating the drug. This is the NCCN guidelines, and you can see this is highlighted. The maintenance should be given for 1 year for intermediate risk and 3 years for high risk NMIBC. So this is very clear. If the patient is the high risk, give 3 years of maintenance. If the patient is the intermediate risk, give 1 year at least for maintenance. And dose reduction is encouraged if there are substantial local symptoms during maintenance therapy. And BCG has enough data to prove that it can prevent the recurrence. Okay. So this is the now available brand or drug of BCG called OncoBCG, supplied by Cipla Pharma, manufactured by Serum India, and each vial contains around 40 milligram per ml, which comes to be around 10 to power 8 coliforming units. They don't have any preservative or antibiotics in the formulation. So administration and usually done by technicians. So I don't think any urologist is now doing BCG, or maybe if there's such a busy practice that we don't do by ourselves. So our technicians should be should be trained, maybe supervised and maybe guided, because this is not a very simple therapeutic agent, this is a very toxic agent. So aseptic techniques, drain the urine completely and instill the drug slow by gravity. You should not push it. And retain for 2 hours. Ask the patient not to ingest any fluid 4 hours before or 2 hours after. And yeah. I'll like to ask Sir Kalyan Sir and Sir, do you ask your patient to lie down on the stomach and then turn around and in different position for some time?
Yeah, we do.
You do it?
Yeah. But that is because we have been doing it for
yeah. Well, I don't find any reason for that because
there is no scientific
reason. Yeah, blood is not a fixed cavity. It's a flexible, cavity. So it adjusts to the amount of fluid that is there in the bladder. So anyway, the whole bladder mucosal surface is in contact with the drug any time. So I feel there is no reason.
Practice, for there is a scientific justification.
Yeah. Thiotepa is a heavier solution, and that settled at the bottom of the bladder. So this is the reason. Actually, it was traditionally used.
Once the BCG solution is within the bladder, mixes with urine. So it doesn't matter whether
I think, sir, yeah, I see uniform solution.
I think it keeps the patient busy. So,
look at the
hydrostatics
of the thing. It's absolutely useless. Anyway,
I think that's
a better question. Thiotepa is a fact, sir. Thiotepa, when it was used in the 80s, this is the reason.
In BCG nowadays, it is not just. In BCG nowadays,
BCG is also not a solution, it's a suspension.
Right.
So I don't know. You'll have to. Let us not be
theoretical. I tried to find, but there is no evidence, no guidelines, and no suggestion. But it's a common practice. That's why we're using it.
It was a common practice.
Right.
Yeah. So even BCG is not a solution. It's a suspension. So a contact time may be important. How do you know? How do you prove it is not important?
How can you prove that it is getting caught?
What is the harm in telling the patients to lie on?
Yes.
I think that's a great explanation, that it keeps the patients busy, it keeps the patient into the treatment, so he's feels he's involved in the treatment. So great idea. Yeah. But he occupies one bed in recovery period. Yeah. Anyway, so and then ask the patient to avoid instant continuous sitting position. This is I don't know why they ask the patient to sit and then avoid. But they are in.
Patient could stand up at pass it.
I think the reason for sitting and voiding is some of these toxins, especially mitomycin C, is toxic to your skin.
Okay.
So if you stand and void,
okay,
the chance of spraying and
right.
Spillage.
So maybe that's the reason behind having you people here. Thank you, sir. So this is one of the great reasons told by sir, because this is a potentially hazardous drug. It should be handled carefully. If there is contamination on skin, it can cause symptoms, it can cause problems, right? And if there is a bleeding or other signs, maybe you would avoid the treatment for 1 week. And for 6 hours, whatever urine the patient passes has to be thoroughly disinfected, maybe segregated, because of cross-contamination of BCG. So how long the patient should get BCG? So what is the optimal BCG schedule? So sir, this is an interesting story, because Morels got those drugs which were shipped in container six pack. So he started using six, but there is no scientific reason why six, why not four, why not 10, or why not 8. So, but this is the thing we do.
You see, nobody dares to change this system.
Right. So 6 weekly schedules as introduced by Morels in 1976. And for optimal efficacy, it should be given for maintenance schedule. And EOTCGU meta-analysis showed that maintenance BCG was unable to. So in meta-analysis, they were not able to find out which BCG maintenance was the most effective, because there are various regimens given for maintenance therapy. And but Bohle et al. Found out that at least 1 year of maintenance is required to obtain superiority of BCG over mitomycin. So this was the final result of EORTCGU group, and they concluded that there is no difference in toxicity between 1/3 dose and full dose, that is 120 and 40 milligram. But intermediate risk patients should be treated with full dose 1 year. So there is no indication for decreasing the dose in high-risk patients. 1 year full dose should be given. Full dose 3 years reduces recurrence as compared with full dose 1 year, but no progression or death. And the benefit of the two additional years of maintenance should be weighed against the cost and benefit as of treatment, as I say.
And toxicity.
Yeah, of toxicity. So this was about the duration and the dose. I will now deal with the whether screening urine analysis should be done or not. So before instilling BCG, do you routinely ask patient to get with the urine routine and culture reports? Yeah. So even we do. And concurrent fluoroquinolones like